Sunday morning. Let's stand together as we begin a song this morning. Worthy of worship, and He is worthy. Let's sing together.
Worthy of worship, worthy of praise, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all the glad songs we can sing.
God's people said amen. Welcome this morning to Bible Baptist Church early service worship. We are glad that you're here, very glad that you're here. It has been a rough week, and as you know, a lot of our folks have been affected with illness, and we did have one passing of Brother Jimmy Strickland. I want to clarify that it's Jimmy and Susie Strickland, because we have two Jim Stricklands, so I want to make sure we understand that. And was hospitalized, of course, but then had a massive stroke, and that just did not recover from that. So please pray for the Strickland family this morning, especially, and we will keep you updated as we get more information. They're delaying the services some because their son Nicholas is also in the hospital, and they want to make sure that he gets out and is well before they plan those services for Jim Strickland. So to remember them this morning in prayer. On a more positive note, we did hear that Brian Salvi is in a regular room now, and his wife Beth has been able to visit him, which is the first time in a couple weeks. So there's a sign of progress there. So keep remembering Brian Salvi. There are many others in the church that are, we have several that are dealing with the illness themselves, but then we have probably three times that who have been forced to quarantine or to be cautious because of that. So we've got a lot of folks out, and we'll be praying for all of them. And then breaking news was the earthquake in Haiti. I contacted our missionary there. He and his family are well, but they are not far from where a lot of the devastation was. So they're spending today with teams going to try to help in those areas. So they've just been through it down there. The assassination of the president, and then now the earthquake and the tropical storm has them in their sights as well. So a lot to pray for this morning. And Jesus said, "My Father's house shall be called a house of prayer." So let's today gather in prayer and worship and praise of the Lord. But let's ask a special blessing on all of these folks this morning. So, Brother Schuyler, would you come? And we are going to share in the announcement time a few changes on our calendar. As I told you, we would plan accordingly and make adjustments as needed. And so there's a couple things we're going to have to change up a little bit, but we'll share that in the announcement time. So, Brother Schuyler, would you come and pray? Remember the Strickland family, especially today.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before your throne today, Lord, just to lift up the Strickland family right now. Lord, we rejoice and we're thankful for the fact that Brother Jimmy is now rejoicing with you, that he's up in heaven with no more sickness or disease, Lord, and that he's with his Heavenly Father. Lord, I just pray for the rest of the Strickland family as they are seeking your comfort right now. Lord, I just pray that they can lean on you, and Lord, that they can just rejoice in the fact that Brother Strickland is in heaven with you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the Salvi family who has gotten this great news, Lord. We just pray for the improved progress and just for the continued improvement of his health. Lord, we pray for the people of Haiti and just for our missionaries, Lord, just for the full situation there. We just pray for a hedge of protection around them all, Lord. Lord, we pray for these services, and we ask you to bless and be with the pastor as he gives the word. Lord, we just thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You may be seated as we continue this morning.
Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard.
Singing, please stand together.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies, and there's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Like a flood comes flowing down. cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. And there's a place where sin and shame are powerless. And there my heart has peace with God and forgiveness. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. Here my hope is found. Here on holy ground.
This morning, we have another special treat, a family special treat. I love family harmony, and my family, we sing a lot, we try to at least, and a few weeks ago, Kevin and I were collaborating on getting a song together, and he said, I think Kevin's going to sing with me. So I said, that sounds amazing. This is a song called Psalm 34, or otherwise known as Oh, Taste and See, and the Brooklyn Tabernacle recorded it a year or two ago, did a great job with it, and let's welcome Kevin and Kevin Thomas.
The Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on Him are radiant, they'll never be ashamed, they'll never be ashamed.
This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me, and saved me from my enemy. The Son of God surrounds His saints, He will deliver them, He will deliver them. Magnify the Lord with me. Come exalt His name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name forever. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, blessed is he, yeah, who hides in him. Oh, fear the Lord. Oh, all you saints, he'll give you everything. Come exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name forever. Magnify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Come exalt his name forever. Bless the Lord
every day and night.
Never ending praise. May our incense rise. Bless the Lord every day. May our incense rise. Bless the Lord every day. May our incense rise. Bless the Lord every day. May our incense rise. That the Lord is good, he'll give you everything. He'll give you everything.
Amen. Thank you, Kevin and Kevin. Not to be confused with Daryl and Daryl. Amen. Wonderful song based on scripture and family harmony, as Jody said. Thank you for sharing that this morning. Well, before we stand, and we're going to be in the Gospel of Luke in just a few moments, but let's look at our spotlight on scripture today. The book of Romans is where we're at in our schedule going left to right in our Bibles. We're looking at the book of Romans. And so if we have that slide ready, we'll share that this morning before we go to Luke. The book of Romans was written in approximately 57 AD near the conclusion of Paul's third missionary journey. It has sometimes been called a theology textbook for its thorough explanation of the Christian life. Pastor Bill Monroe will be doing our revival. I'll talk to you about that in a minute. But he's preached 52 years in one pulpit, in one place. And he said, in his estimation, the book of Romans may be the most important book in the entire Bible, the book of Romans. And so it's a very important book. And it thoroughly explains the Christian life. And unlike Paul's other letters to the churches, Romans was addressed to a congregation he'd never met. All of the other churches, he had been there, he had ministered there, he had preached there. This one, he had never yet arrived, but he intended to. He addressed the congregation. He planned to go as soon as possible, and ultimately he did preach in Rome, but he was a prisoner when he made it to Rome on his way to Caesar. In Romans, we have the gospel according to Paul, is another way to look at the book. There are more Old Testament quotations in Romans than in all the other epistles combined. Some 70 quotations from 14 different Old Testament books. And in this way, Paul demonstrated the fact that the gospel message is the same throughout all ages. In the first few chapters, Paul focuses on the darkness of human sin and his condemnation before God. This is where we find all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and there's none righteous, that none that doeth good, no, not one. And he focuses on the condition and our condemnation before God. And he then turns to the question of salvation and shows that when God forgives, he does it freely and forever. Aren't you glad about that? And talks about whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We'll see that in a moment. And Paul shows that God saves from the power of sin as well as the penalty of sin. He talks about if God be for us, who can be against us? And there's no condemnation now to them who are in Christ Jesus. And so he saves from the penalty, and through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, sin, self, and Satan can all be subdued in practical daily Christian living. He clearly teaches that there's only one way of salvation for Jew and Gentile alike, and that is faith in Jesus Christ. He said, for there is no difference. And he talks about the branches, the natural branches, and the wild branches grafted in. The scriptures in Romans are widely used for soul winning and evangelism, as Paul lays out the Romans road to salvation, which culminates in Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Every Christian should be familiar with this book and learn the scriptures to help point others to Jesus Christ. So a very powerful book, the book of Romans. Now, in Luke chapter number 24, would you stand with us, please, as we read the scriptures together today. Luke chapter number 24. And talking this morning about, in our Sunday school and life group studies that we'll be joined here at 9:15, we're talking about God's love and our love for Him. And this message goes hand in glove with that as we look at the story of the Emmaus walk, or the road to Emmaus, as you may have heard, in chapter 24, verse 13. And behold, speaking of the disciples, now Christ has risen, and we see in verse 13, behold, two of them, that is disciples, went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 80 furlongs. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communication are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are sad? And the one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? And he said unto them, what things? And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. And when they found not his body, they came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which had said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Notice verse 25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken? Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Most of you in here are old enough to remember many years ago, it's probably been 15 to 16 years ago, the movie called The Passion of the Christ. Anybody see that or have that on DVD? Excuse me. Brother Ed, if you could bring that water to me right there, I would appreciate it. It's on the front row and a little tickle in my throat. But that movie, The Passion of Christ, thank you so much. Appreciate that. The Passion of Christ was a blockbuster. It went all over the world, not just here in America, but went all over the world, and people were moved. Many people who had no idea of what had happened on the cross and why it had happened and how everything had transpired. They didn't know and had seen it. And now, please don't get me wrong. While that was I've seen excerpts of it. I've never seen the whole thing. But while that was a certainly well done, Hollywood many times messes up the Bible. Amen. I remember talking to a guy one time. He said, "I don't need to read the Bible. I saw the movie." Well, if you saw the movie, you missed a great deal of the Bible. But that phrase, the Passion of Christ, became very popular. It was very much a part of the discussion. As a matter of fact, in our small town, we had some teams trained that when people left the movie theater, we had New Testaments to hand out to them and invitations to church. And if we could strike up a conversation of sharing the gospel right there in the parking lot, and several people were saved, and that was happening all across the country. Probably happened here in Savannah as well. But people were moved. People were simply amazed at what Christ had done. Many who had never heard or seen the details before. And millions of people across the country and around the world were confronted with the evidence of Jesus' death for their sins. And that phrase, Passion of Christ, refers to the events from the Lord's Supper to the death of the Savior on Golgotha's hill. And today, though, I don't want to preach about that. You say, well, that's an Easter message. No, that's an everyday message. The fact that Jesus Christ died for you is an everyday message. And I want to preach this morning about the Passion of Christ for you. The Passion of Christ for you. In our text, Jesus appears to two of the disciples while they're walking to the village of Emmaus. In their grief and confusion, they don't even recognize him. The Bible's very clear. Their eyes were beholden that they didn't know him. Didn't recognize him until he ultimately revealed himself to them later. And our key verse is found in there 24 through 26 when Jesus says, ought not Christ to have suffered these things? And that's the phrase I want to focus in on this morning. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And today, this morning, I want to encourage you and challenge you. And I know we've had many, many visitors in the last few months. And I praise the Lord for that every Sunday that God sends us new visitors. But I always want to make sure, no matter what I'm preaching about, that we don't lose sight of the fact that some people may be hearing about the Passion of Christ for the first time. Some people may not understand what Jesus did and why he did it. And so I want to be sure that every so often that I have a message that really speaks to the heart about the cross, as the song was sung, at the cross, I surrender my life. And I want to talk today about the Passion of Christ for you. Why did he suffer these things? Why did he? They gave the story how he was delivered to the sinful men, how he was crucified and put in that tomb. And they gave the details, but why did he do that? Why did he suffer these things? First of all, Christ suffered these things to reveal God's evaluation of human life. Think about this. In Jesus' day, life was cheap. And it is in our day as well, isn't it? Life is cheap in today's society. In Roman times, an unwanted child would be disposed of. That doesn't sound so ancient, does it? An unwanted child would be disposed of. A slave might be killed by his master for any reason. Emperor Nero, it's reported, lighted his garden with human torches. Christians were cast to the lions as entertainment for a crowd of spectators. Life was very cheap in that day. But God has a high evaluation of life. Amen? Because God breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul, and every human being is made in the image and likeness of God. And so God has a high evaluation of life. And consider the little children that came to Jesus, and the disciples thought they were a nuisance and wanted to push them aside, but Jesus said, no, suffer the little children, let them come unto me. And God talks about the Bible talks about their guardian angels that these little children have. And every life is important to God. Every life has value to God. Every life matters to God. And on in our day, life is also cheap. We hear of senseless violence and murders every day. Every day, senseless violence and murders. Every weekend, they give the statistics on Monday of how many people died in Chicago, how many people died in New York, how many people died here and there. And whether it was a school shooting in New Mexico just the other day, or whether it was an attack on police officers, or whether it was some other crime of that you've read about or heard about. Senseless violence and murders. Terrorism. Christians being murdered in Muslim countries. We glorify killing and death in movies and video games. And I've said it before, but it really makes my blood boil that the people who became millionaires by being in movies with guns are speaking out about guns. But we're the hypocrites. Don't get me started. I don't think my message would go over in Hollywood, but somebody should send it out there. Glorifying killing and death in video games and movies, not to mention abortion. Some of the same senators and representatives and president and vice president who are so viciously angry about guns are the same people who have promoted and protected abortion. Did you know that you can be imprisoned and fined up to $250,000 for killing a bald eagle? But a teenager can get a government-paid-for abortion in many states without their parents' consent. Life is cheap in our day. Kill the babies, but don't you dare touch a feather on that eagle. Life is cheap in our day as it was then, but in God's eyes, life is not cheap. And Jesus suffered these things. Jesus suffered these things because God has a high evaluation of human life. It is supremely valuable. It's given of God. God is the giver of life. He's the breath of life. And God made you in his image and likeness. And so Jesus went to the cross. He suffered these things because of your life. You know, life can't be cheap to God when he was willing to give his only begotten son to save it. John 3:16 tells us that very clearly. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The most prized creation on all of this earth, all of this planet, is not the trees or the animals, not the mountains or the rivers. The most prized creation on all of this planet is you. You. God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten son. And so we see that Jesus suffered these things because God values human life. Secondly, he suffered these things to reveal the essence of God's character. And here's where we tie in with Sunday school a little bit. 1 John chapter 4, the essence of God's character. 1 John 4:8 says that he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And drop down to verse 10. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins, the atonement, the payment, the sacrifice. He loved you so much, and the essence of his character, that God is love, sent Jesus to suffer these things. So Jesus is reasoning with these disciples. He said, ought not Christ, don't you understand? If you understood who God was and you understood how much God loved you, this would all make sense. And that's why we have to explain that message. That's why we have to teach and preach Jesus Christ. That's why we have to go into the highways and hedges. That's why we have to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Because God's character is such love. He is love. He doesn't just love. He is love, the Bible tells us. And we demonstrate that we know him, as we'll discuss in our Sunday school classes. We demonstrate that we know him through our love that is displayed through us. Romans 5:8, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. As we read these verses, I want that verse back there in Luke to be echoing in your mind. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things? Jesus is saying it makes perfect sense when you know who God is. It makes perfect sense what I did on that cross, what I suffered at the hands of those sinful men. When I laid down my life as a lamb, it makes perfect sense when you understand the essence of who God is. And God commended, he proved his love, or he showed his love. I guess an easier word would be demonstrated. He demonstrated his love. He showed his love in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for us. We could never understand God's character without the cross. We never could see it. The cross reveals God in his limitless love, his boundless mercy, and his pardoning grace. The love of God is culminated in the cross of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus asked the question, ought Christ not to have suffered? Ought he? This was part of the plan. This was God's plan to redeem mankind from the Garden of Eden. This makes perfect sense when you know who God is. When you know who God is. On Wednesday night, a couple weeks ago, we have something on Wednesday nights called church. And just in case you didn't know, and we got some new Bible study classes that are starting here in September. They're out there at the Welcome Center. You can register for them. We'll go back to a classroom format. But I was talking about the cross, and I was talking about the demonstration, how that God, the love of God is revealed through that cross. And we can talk about it, we can say it, but this is what the illustration was. A preacher shared with us at a pastor's conference, and some of you were here on Wednesday night, so this is not new to you. And he said, we spend most of our time, and this is true, I have to testify, we spend most of our time trying to get God's people to live for God. We do. We try to, we beat our heads against the wall, Brother Gary, trying to get God's people just to do right, We teach it, we preach it, we open the church doors, we turn the lights on, we pay the air conditioning bill. We want you all to come so that you can learn how to live for God. And we go after it and after it and after it and after it. And probably 70 to 80% of our time is spent as pastors trying to get people to live for God. Can you say amen to that? But here's the disconnect. And the preacher was very true. It was right. He said, people won't live for God until they love God. And they won't love God until they learn about God. It's the three L's. Learn, love, and then live. And you can go through the motions. You can go through the actions. You can go through the habits, but if you don't love God, you're not going to live for God. You're going to be one of those on-the-spot Christians. You're going to do what you have to when you have to. You follow what I'm saying? But you're not going to live for God because you don't love God. And I'm afraid many times people have not really fallen in love with God because they have not learned enough about him. And so Jesus is teaching them. If you notice, it says he talked about all the scriptures concerning himself. He talked all about that. Notice in verse number 27, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. He went all the way back to Moses. The books of Moses, the Torah, he went all the way back to the beginning. Because in the beginning was God, was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. So he goes all the way back to the books of Moses, and he begins to teach them the things concerning himself. And friend, if you don't know about him, you're not going to love him. You know, we love people, the more we know them, the more we love them. You follow what I'm saying? You can love in a general term, but to really love somebody, you really love somebody is because you know them. Amen? You know them. They're your close friends. I have lots of acquaintances. I have lots, and I can say that I love them in Christian love. You with me? And then I have some friends that I could say, I love those guys. And then I have some people that are even closer, that closer circle, that you really, I mean, these are the people that you would get up in the middle of the night and you'd go change their flat tire on the side of the highway. You know what I mean? You'd do whatever you could to help them out. You really love them. But then there's that family, or there's those really close, maybe it's a small group in your circle, but there's people that you would, I mean, you would die for. You are the closest to them and they to you. And so you have a different, what I'm trying to show you is that love has different levels, doesn't it? Different levels. But the ones that you know the most, the ones that you're the closest to, the ones you spend the most time with, are usually the ones that you love the most. And we'll not love him if we're not with him. If we're not in the Word, if we're not following him, if we're not learning about him, if we're not expounding the Scriptures and understanding who he is, and the more we know about him, the more we love him, and the more we love him, the more we live for him. Stay with me. God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It reveals him not as a God of vengeance, the essence of God's character, not as a God of vengeance, but as a loving shepherd willing to give his life for the sheep. John chapter 10, verse 11, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things? Yes. Yes. Because of who God is, God's estimation of life. He was not content to let people die and go to hell. He was not content to see people waste their lives. So he sent his son. The essence of his character is love. Also, he suffered these things to reveal God's estimate of sin, number three. His estimate of sin, his evaluation of life, his essence of character, and the estimate of sin. Only as we look at the cross and what Jesus did for us can we realize the awfulness of sin in the sight of God. When we look at the cross, remember, God turned away. He turned away that afternoon when Jesus was suspended there between heaven and earth. The sky grew black. And the Son and the Father were separated by sin. Had never happened in the universe. Had never happened in the history of the Trinity that God the Father and God the Son were totally separated as Jesus cried out, Why hast thou forsaken me? When we understand the awfulness of sin, to many sin is funny, even acceptable, getting more so in our generation, more so. We were at chaplains, Georgia's law enforcement chaplains training this week. I was there for 4 days. I have not sat through so many classes since I was in college. You say, I think you didn't think you went to college. Oh, I went. I just didn't stay very long. And I'm sitting there, some days was 10 hours. We started at 8 and got done at 6. And I'm sitting in all these classrooms, and it was nothing new that I didn't know. I had all that training in Ohio. I just had to get a Georgia stamp. A Georgia stamp. Brother Gary? Yep. So I had to get that. And I'm sitting there, and a couple of times the different presenters said, oh, you've got to be careful not to be offended by language because police officers have some pretty bad language. And I can testify of that. But I also was a fire chaplain for a while, and they put the policemen to shame. They got some mouths on them, and you can't have thin skin if you're a chaplain. If you're trying to minister to these people, you've got to be where they're at, and you've got to... you just got to let that stuff go. I had one deputy up in Ohio. The others would laugh at me because they said, he doesn't cuss like that normally. He just does it when you're here because he's afraid of you. He doesn't want you to be around him, so he thinks that if he cusses enough. I had some Baptists like that. They think if they cuss enough, the preacher will leave them alone. Oh, no, that's just like saying sick 'em to a bulldog, amen? They said, he don't cuss like that when you're not around. He just, he don't want you to be, he don't want you, he don't want to cross that line and you preach to him or whatever. So he's trying to push you away. But anyway, my point was this. They're talking about how these police officers cuss, and I'm over here in different conversations in the chaplain's group, and they're doing a pretty good job of cussing. Episcopal priest with a collar around his neck, he let some big ones go. I thought, good night, nurse. We don't have to be like them, amen? We don't have to try to outdo them. We think sin is funny sometimes. We talk about little sins and big sins. But sin is sin. In God's estimation of sin, it's all bad. You understand what I'm trying to say? There are no good sins. I got to get that again. There are no good sins. When you look at the cross, which of your sins is acceptable? Not any of them. Not any of our sins are acceptable in the eyes of God. And so mankind looks at sin and thinks that's not that bad. It's not hurting anybody. It's not causing any problems. But oh, my friend, it caused a lot of problems. That'll preach. It's not going over very well here, but it'll preach somewhere in America. It caused a lot of problems. Sin caused a lot of problems. And your sin and my sin separated the sinless Son of God from the Holy Father God. Sin has a price tag. Your drinking, Jesus had to die for that. Your swearing, Jesus had to die for that. Your addiction, Jesus had to die for that. Your little white lies, Jesus had to die for that. Your cheating on the test, Jesus had to die for that. Your lust of another woman, Jesus had to die for that. Your pornography, Jesus had to die for that. I can go on and on all day, friend. In God's eyes, there is no good sin. And Jesus had to suffer these things, not for our mistakes, not for our weaknesses, not for our slip-ups, not for our poor choices. Jesus suffered these things for our sin. But what is sin, really, by definition? Webster's and Merriam-Webster's and all those others, Oxford, they'll all give you a little different slant on it, but let me tell you what it is. Let me give you the Baptist definition of sin, all right? Say, well, I'm not a Baptist. Well, you're in a Baptist church, so hang on. Let me give you the Baptist definition of sin. It's a pretty long definition. Sin takes the Holy Son of God, incarnate in the flesh, sinless in thought and word and deed, righteous, pure, and holy, and sin treats him like no animal should ever be treated. Beaten to a pulp, bloodied from head to toe, his back ripped into ribbons of flesh, unrecognizable to his own mother. Sin then nails him to a wooden cross and leaves him alone to die. Stripped, naked, beaten, spat upon, pierced with nails, and mocked by a hateful crowd. That's sin. God says that there is no good sin, and that sin is so bad that only the blood of Christ could do anything about it. Isn't that something? All your religion can't do anything about it. All your good works can't do anything about it. All your tithes and offerings can't do anything about it. All your good deeds to your neighbor can't do anything about your sin. The only thing that can affect your sin is the precious blood of Christ. John 1:29, John the Baptist sees Jesus coming unto him and said, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. If it took the death of Jesus Christ to wash away your sins, then sin is very bad. And ought not Christ to have suffered these things? He suffered them because of his estimate of sin. And then number four, he suffered these things to reveal the evidence of God's power. the evidence of God's power. The power of God, first of all, to challenge the hearts of sinful men. Notice Romans 1, 16. We referenced Romans earlier. Paul said, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek," verse 17. "For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith," verse 18. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness." Jesus suffered to challenge the hearts of sinful men. The story of the cross brings conviction to the heart of every man and woman who hears it and understands what Jesus did for them. And I don't know if you picked up on it or not, but I've been preaching in pulpits for nearly 30 years. When you start talking about sin and preaching about sin, there's a holy hush that comes across people. Because you may have been saved for 50 years, but when you're reminded about what your sin did to Jesus Christ, it challenges you. And I dare say that we don't have more conviction in the churches of America because we don't have preaching about sin. And the less we preach about it, the more prevalent sin becomes. The more prevalent sin becomes, the farther people get away from God. The farther people get away from God, the less they're living for God. And there's the cycle all over again and all over again. The story of the cross brings conviction. Notice John 15, 13. "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." And the conviction comes from understanding the message of the cross and the penalty of sin. And because we're not preaching about the cross, the emphasis comes to Jesus being just our friend and too little emphasis on Jesus being our Savior from sin. So he suffered these things, the evidence of the power of God to challenge us, and then the power of God to atone for our sins. Very quickly, rapid succession. Hebrews 9:22, please. "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission." 2 Corinthians 5:21, "For he that is God the Father hath made him that is God the Son to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." 1 John 2:2. "And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." 1 Peter 2:24, "Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed." The power of God to challenge our sin, the power of God to atone for our sins, and the power of God to change us. Notice 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ," do I have it? I might have skipped it. "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new." 2 Corinthians 5:17. Friend, the passion of Christ for you, he suffered these things. Jesus said it had to be so. Jesus said it makes sense. It was the only way that you could be reconciled to God. It was the only bridge that could be crossed. It was the only payment for the sins of mankind. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things? Oh, he suffered. Notice Isaiah 53, 4 through 6, if we have that. "Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions." Would you read it with me? "He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." Verse 6, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." Ought not Christ to have suffered? Yes, he suffered, but he suffered for a reason. He suffered for a reason. And the person wearing your shoes right now is the reason he suffered these things. Song says, "Once a man who we know as the Son of God hung upon a cruel tree, he suffered pain as no mortal man. He took my place. He did it all for me. He did it all for me. He did it all for me. Each drop of blood was shed for even me. When the Savior cried, bowed his head and died. Oh, praise his name. He did it all for me. Ought not Christ to have suffered? Yes, he did. It was the only way you could be saved. One day, if you're saved, you're going to be walking the streets of heaven. When I was meeting with the Strickland family, I was comforted and tried to comfort them in knowing this. We didn't get to see him those last few days. Protocols, hospital rules wouldn't allow that. Oh, but we're going to see him again. Amen. And when we see him, there'll be no ventilator, there'll be no tubes, there'll be no wires, there'll be no pain. There'll be no doctors tending to him. One of these days, you're going to be walking the streets of heaven. Some of you will be there early. Some of us will get there late. One way or the other, if you're saved, we're going to be there. And when you get there, you're going to realize afresh and anew that the only reason you're there is because Christ suffered these things. The only reason you're in heaven, the only reason you're saved, the only reason you have the hope of eternal life is because Christ suffered these things for you. Would you bow in prayer, please? Our heads are bowed and eyes closed before we stand and sing. Brother Jody's coming. The music will play softly. I want to encourage you, and I know that we have many, many people watching online as well. And you may be watching this morning and you may not be saved. You may not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And I want to give you this opportunity in the quietness and stillness of this moment to examine your heart, to see if you know that you're saved, to ask the question, do I know for sure that when I die, I'm going to heaven? Do I know that for sure? If you have confidence, if you have prayed to receive Christ as your Savior, and you have absolute confidence that, yes, Pastor, I know for sure that when my time comes, I'm going to be in heaven because I have put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone. If that's your testimony, would you lift your hand right up and right back down all over the building? God bless you and thank you. You may put them down. And of course, you're watching online. Many of you are saved and you know the Lord. But today, if you're not certain that you're saved, you're not certain, you're like these disciples saying, why did this happen? Why did Christ go through what he went through? And I hope that today I have illuminated just a little bit, given you understanding, learning about God, that you might love him for what he had done, that you might live for him and come to him. Whether you're here in this auditorium or watching online, I invite you today to pray with me. If you're not certain of salvation, would you pray, Dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I confess that. I believe you died on the cross for my sins, in my place, because of your great love for me. And I believe that you rose from the dead. And today, as best I know how, I call upon you to be my Savior, to forgive my sin, and to help me live for you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand and join us as we sing today? There are many reasons for prayer. You may want to come to this altar praying for the folks, the Americans and the military heading back into harm's way in Afghanistan, the people in Haiti, people dealing with COVID virus, whatever is on your heart. And if you're not saved, we would love to be able to show you personally from the Bible this morning how you can trust Christ as your Savior. Other decisions, other requests. You come as we sing.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior and life and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face.
heart today.
Life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us and no more has dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Thank you so much. Please be seated. We're going to share just a few announcements and then...